Okay, as you have realized, today we are going to study about Laodicea, message to the seventh, to the last church in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. Laodicea is in modern day Turkey, and unlike many of the cities, it was in the elevated plain.
When we read message to Laodicea,
Is there any encouragement there? No single encouragement. And some of you, you always try to find something nice, something positive. But sometimes there is nothing positive to say about somebody. That's reality. And Jesus, that almost always starts with something positive, here he has nothing positive to say. So the church is apparently not doing much good. And Jesus has a number of rebukes, and we are going to go to those rebukes. First one is they are lukewarm. So Laodicea was supplied with hot water from hot springs of Hierapolis, which was around 6 miles from Laodicea. By the time water reached Laodicea, water became lukewarm. So it was good to have a bath, but it was distasteful to drink. If it was hot or cold, it would be better to drink. But being lukewarm, it wasn't nice. People didn't like it, and they constantly complain about that. And what Jesus is trying to do is, he is trying to communicate the message to them. And he is thinking, okay, so how can you understand that I'm not happy with your spirituality? And Jesus is using this information about lukewarm water to tell them. So Jesus is sort of, Jesus is sort of saying this, you know, when you wake up in the morning and you would like to have a tea, I don't know if they were drinking tea or not, but today this would be like, you want to drink tea, and then, you know, it's lukewarm. Who of you likes lukewarm tea? I don't know if there is anybody. Maybe, you know, in one of my churches in Serbia, the elder was a little bit upset when I was talking about this. He said, my mother, she likes lukewarm water. Okay, she was exception. Okay? But generally, we don't like lukewarm tea. We want it hot. And Jesus is saying this, if I would give you a lukewarm tea, you would spit it out, you wouldn't like it. The same is in your spirituality. I don't like it. You are lukewarm. Then Jesus says, you are poor. Well, were they materially poor? No, they were very, very rich. They didn't see themselves poor. So Jesus is saying, though you are materially rich, you are spiritually poor. There is no growth, no life in you. Your pockets are full, but your heart is empty. Then a third point. You are blind. This city was known for cream that people would use if they had eye health problems. And people would come from far away to get this cream. But Jesus is using again something that was familiar to them to illustrate their problem. And Jesus says, ironically, this is the place where you can buy a cream to help if you have eye problem. But spiritually, you are blind and you need to get cream from me. And the last point was, you are naked. Well, They were rich, they were definitely were not naked. Not just they were not naked, but they had the best that they could buy at that time. In that area, there was well-known black wool that was produced. And people would come from around to buy this special wool. So it was sort of like, you know, designer label. Like, you know, oh, he has Armani or something like that. And then God says, you are naked. They could not really understand some point. But Jesus is saying, physically, oh, you have nice clothes, no problem. But spiritually, you are naked. You are impoverished, you are blind, you are naked, you are poor, you are not growing, you are not loving God. You are lukewarm. So this was their situation. They thought that everything was good, but they were lukewarm, poor, blind, and naked spiritually. The real issue was that they would worship comfort instead of Jesus. And Jesus called them to do that which is for them uncomfortable. And they would rather not go to uncomfortable areas. Most of us, we do not worry tomorrow what are we going to eat or to have clothes. We take that for granted. And this can lead us into lethargy, where we feel like we are fine. We don't need Jesus. And Jesus comes and he tells, though physically or materially, you're okay. Spiritually, you have problems. And I'm very, very concerned for your spirituality. And if you really compare rich countries and poor countries, who is ignoring and putting Jesus aside more? People in rich countries or poor countries? In rich countries. Because no, we have everything. Why would I need Jesus? And Jesus is saying, your problem are not finances. Your problem is spirituality. It's very easy to point finger and people in Laodicea and say, ah, oh boy, you know. But it's so hard to look at our heart. So let's pause for a moment before we continue analyzing what God is telling them. And think about ourselves and ask a few questions. First question is, what is your relationship with Jesus? Are you cold? Are you hot? Or lukewarm? What is your motivation? What is your practical life? What is your spirituality? Are you cold? Are you hot? Are you lukewarm? And if we are honest, many of us would say, oh, I'm lukewarm. If we are honest. And this is a problem. Lukewarm is not good. Why is Jesus saying it's better to be even cold? Of course, we understand why it's better to be cold or hot. But why cold? Because lukewarm, I'm fine. I don't have problems. And with cold, God can reach that person and say, you know, you are cold. And the person is going to say, yeah, I'm missing something. But lukewarm is the worst position. Second question is, what about your church? Is your church cold, hot, or lukewarm? The same question. Do you have a zeal? Do you have a passion? Are you serving, caring, you know, caring for the lost? Or you're just lukewarm? The third question is, what helps you to be hot, to be passionate? Is it reading the Bible, praying, coming on Sabbath to the church, coming for a Bible study, having a solitude and thinking about spirituality and God? What is it? And do you continue to do these things so that you can stay hot? Or you just forget these things and no wonder you are lukewarm. So the point is, are you protecting your spirituality? Next question is, what keeps you from becoming hot? Is it surfing the internet? Is it watching the TV? Is it being with that person, spending a lot of time with a certain individual? What is it that keeps you away from being hot, being passionate, being zealous for God? Another question that we should ask is, do you lack sense of urgency? Now, it's just fine, I have time, you know, Jesus is not coming soon, or you know, it's not so bad, because we compare ourselves with those that are much worse than us. So these are the questions that I would like us to go home and think about. Because it's very easy to read about Laodicea, church in Laodicea, and say, but we should actually analyze ourselves and realize where we really are. If you are really hot, thanks God for that. But many of us, sadly, are not hot. And I doubt that we are cold because we will not be here. So very likely, most of us are lukewarm. But we need to honestly analyze ourselves and to ask questions. Where am I? And the message that God has for them apply to most of us. Poor, naked, lukewarm, all these things apply to most of us. And because of this, Jesus gives some commandments and some promises to them and to us today. Revelation 3 verse 18. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear, so that you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes, so that you can see. So what is the first thing? Gold refined in fire. What is Jesus saying is, come and I will give you gold refined in fire. Right? Is it what he says? No. What does he say? I can hear you. Buy. So there is a big difference. Come and I will give you, or come and buy. So what is the big difference? You need to give something in order to get. So Jesus is not saying, come and you can get it for free. So, gold refined in fire and clothes and this eye cream is not free. You need to buy it. Okay, so what do they or what do we need to give in exchange? Are we talking about pounds? Should I sell my house to get it? Is that what Jesus is asking for exchange? What is Jesus asking them? They have a problem with pride, with self-sufficiency. And Jesus is saying, I want that. If you want me to give you gold refined in fire, I need your pride. I need your self-sufficiency. It's completely different stock market. You don't give pounds. You don't give gold. You give yourself. You surrender yourself. This is what Jesus is asking. In order to get this gold refined in fire. So what is gold in this context?
Character,
okay. It's faith. 1 Peter 1:7, we are not going to read. It says it's faith which has been tested. So gold refined in the fire is faith that has been tested. So you want to have faith? I need you to surrender your pride and self-sufficiency. A person could be financially fine and okay, but wealth cannot secure happiness or spirituality. So Jesus asks us to surrender our self-sufficiency, and then he can give us faith. Then he says, buy clothes. So this white clothes, what is it? In the Bible, Christ's righteousness. So we are not self-sufficient again. Our self-sufficiency cannot help us. We need to surrender our self-sufficiency because our righteousness is like, in the Bible, what does it say? Filthy clothes. Okay? So we need to trade filthy righteousness for true Christ's righteousness. Third thing is cream for eyes. And we need to start with this. Jesus mentioned this as a third thing. But actually we need to start with this. Why? Because if I don't properly see my nakedness, you think that I will ask for clothes? What is that story about emperor and clothes? He was deceived that, you know, there is invisible clothes. Nobody could really see whatever. And everybody would say, wow, beautiful clothes, because they were afraid to say the reality. He could not see it. And this is our situation. We need this cream for our eyes so that we can see our true condition. What is our true condition? We are spiritually naked. And what is this cream for our spiritual problem? Who can really, or what can really help us to see? The Holy Spirit. This cream, this is the Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can show what is really in our heart. So Jesus says, come and buy. So you need to give something. You need to surrender your self-sufficiency. Because they were relying on themselves. If there was earthquake or anything, they needed clothes, they needed food, they didn't rely on anybody else. They were so rich. And Jesus said, when it comes to material things, yeah, it works. But when it comes to spiritual things, it does not work. You are not sufficient. You cannot get what you need. So what I need is you to surrender your self-sufficiency. Then I will give you the Holy Spirit that will show you your true nakedness, spiritual nakedness. I will give you faith so that you will trust that I can fulfill that emptiness in your heart. I will give you my righteousness, so when God looks at you, He is not going to see a sinner, but He is going to see a saint. Verse 19. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Some of us are in a position that, you know, nobody gets to discipline us. You are not a child anymore, you are a parent. Or you're a grown adult. Maybe you're not even employed, you're self-employed. So nobody comes to tell you off. And is there anybody who likes being criticized? Being pointed out, oh, you need to change this or that. Nobody likes that. But when Jesus comes, what do people do? Some people don't want to hear it. And Jesus says, I love you. Because I rebuke you, that doesn't mean that I hate you. I love you, and because of that, I rebuke you. Jesus is concerned for us, for our salvation. And He is pointing out, you are poor, you are naked, you are blind, and that's what we are. That's what we are. You're lukewarm, this is our condition. And then Jesus says, what I want is, I want you to be earnest, to be committed, to be zealous. And second thing is to repent. So first thing is to be earnest, to be committed, to be zealous. How do I become zealous? Not on my own. So I need to surrender self-sufficiency. And Jesus can make me passionate and zealous. He can. He can make me hot from lukewarm to hot. He can do this. Because He will send the Holy Spirit, He will give me the faith, gift of faith, and He will give us His righteousness. Then He asks us to repent. What does word repent mean? When we go to the Old Testament, word that is used there means to turn direction. So you walk in my direction and then you turn 180 degrees and you go in the opposite direction. This is what repent means in the Bible, changing the direction. Verse 20, first part. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and open the door. Okay, let's stop here. I am standing at the door and I knock. When you think about this verse, what do you think? Jesus is standing in front of my heart, your heart, you know? We are talking about individuals. And He is knocking. Well, originally, this message is not about you as individual or me as individual. I'm not saying that this is not applicable to us as individuals. But originally, He's talking about the church. on church level. So Jesus is standing in front of the church. There is a door and he is knocking. And what do? They lock Jesus out. Why? Maybe because he is too controversial, too opinionated, strong-willed, too divisive. So the church decides, we will get together, but we don't want you to come in. So Jesus is banging at the door of the church. And they open the peephole and they say, who is it? And Jesus says, it's me. And they say, no, we don't want you. You are going to tell us to repent. You are going to tell us that we are wrong. You are going to tell us to give time, money, efforts. And here we have a very nice club. Nice people, influential people are coming here and they don't like to hear what you have to say. So, no. We will meet and you can stay outside. After we finish, maybe we will come to meet you. The whole Bible is about Jesus. The hope for people is through Jesus. And this church, it's so tragic. The Creator, Jesus, is knocking at the door. And they say, no, we don't need you. We are just fine. And how many churches are just like that? A social club. Nothing more. Yes, as individual, we should read this verse and apply in our life. Jesus is standing and knocking at the door of my heart. But originally, Jesus is talking about the church. It's all about Jesus. And Jesus is saying, I want to come in. Whether this is our personal life, a family life, church life, he wants to get in. What is our answer? They did not let Jesus, the Laodicea, church in Laodicea did not let Jesus get in. What is our answer as a Salisbury church? And also, what is my individual answer to this call? Do we really welcome Jesus in our life as a church or as an individual? Verse 22nd part and verse 21. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. So if you listen to me, I will do two things. You will be able to eat with me, and you will be able to sit with me on my throne. In those days, and I'm sure today, you know, if there is an important person, in those days it would be a king. Today, you know, maybe for somebody it would be a queen or a singer or I don't know. You know, you would be honored to eat with that person. And Jesus is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And he says, I would like to have a supper with you. I would like to have lunch with you. What is our answer? And he says also, I would like you to sit on my throne. Imagine, a king, a queen comes and says, oh, I would like you to be a prince. That would be an honor. And Jesus is offering just that. In that day, the emperor was a man named Domitian. And typically, when an emperor would die, then they would pronounce him to be a god. But he didn't want to faint. So he pronounced himself before he died to be a god and start building temples in different areas. And in Laodicea, there was one temple built for him. He wanted to make sure that everybody knew that he is God. And Jesus says, I have a throne above Domitian's throne. And I'm not a ruler like him. I'm a loving ruler. If you come to me, I will forgive your sins, I will heal your life, and you will sit with me at the table. You will feast with me. Also, you will sit with me on my throne. Jesus is a completely different kind of king. Word throne appears 45 times in the book of Revelation. Jesus is the one who sits on this throne. And this goes all the way back to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6 verses 1 to 3. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. Who is this king in Isaiah chapter 6? John chapter 12, 40-41, we are not going to read, tell us that that is Jesus. This is a king who gave up his life, who died for us, so that we can be forgiven, so that we can have eternal life, that we can feast with him, sit upon his throne. Jesus promises people in Laodicea, in church in Laodicea, even more generous and lavish life than they were enjoying right there. Did they accept it? The church really did not continue. In AD 363, there was a Christian council that was held there. But sadly, the whole region grew lukewarm towards Jesus. And today, there are just a handful of believers scattered in the area. It's not the place where Christianity is well known. Jesus was knocking at the door of Laodicean church, and they did not let him in. What about us, individually, and as church here in Salisbury? How are we doing in our walk with Jesus? Are we lukewarm? Are we indifferent? Is the light of the gospel starting to dim, or is it growing brighter and brighter as we repent of sin and come to Jesus and see him as exalted king seated on the throne, who is benevolent, gracious, good, the one in whom we trust? Verse 22. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. What is the Holy Spirit telling you individually and us as a church in Salisbury? What is the message? The message of Laodicea is the message of Adventist Church, people, Christians living today. What is the message? You think that you're okay. You think that you're sufficient. You have everything that you need. But you are lukewarm, you are poor, you are naked, and you are blind. And Jesus is standing at the door, knocking, and saying, let me in. And he is saying, please buy things that I am offering you, which is faith, which is Christ's righteousness, and which is the Holy Spirit. How do we buy these things? There is only one thing that he is asking. Self-sufficiency. Because that's the problem. They were self-sufficient, and they didn't get these three things that Jesus was offering. Are we going to continue to be self-sufficient and to lack faith, Christ's righteousness, and the Holy Spirit? Hopefully not. Amen.
Amen.
That was eye-opening, Rudi. It just shows you that we can be self-sufficient and lose sight, even though we think we know it all in our church. We can fall into that trap. So shall we all stand and sing the closing hymn, Faith is the Victory.
Thank you.
It is not something that we like to hear, but that's reality. We are lukewarm, we are naked, we are poor, and we are blind. Please help us to be willing to surrender our self-sufficiency and to take the faith, the rope, and the Holy Spirit that you are offering to us. Please help us when you knock at the door of our heart as individual or as a church to open and to let you in. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.